The Galapagos Islands are one of the most unique and biologically outstanding areas on the planet. Made famous by Charles Darwin, they've been called a living museum and a showcase of evolution. We set out on our own voyage of discovery, welcomed by animals on six islands. The islands straddle the equator about 1,000 kilometers west of Ecuador. They're actually summits of submarine volcanoes, 13 of them rising from the floor of the Pacific Ocean. The Galapagos first appeared on maps around 1570, and the area was reported as having an abundance of whales, seals, sea lions, and an endless supply of tortoises. Our first stop is a beautiful bay on San Cristobal Island. And what is so amazing and wonderful is the Galapagos animals are unafraid of people. They don't run away, and instead they show an interested curiosity with our presence. The islands are remote and they lack natural predators, and this allowed the animals to evolve to their unique environment, even developing differences between the islands. Darwin eventually came to realize that the animals on each island were not carbon copies of each other, and they would play a key role in the development of his theory of evolution. Our next stop is wonderful Espanola Island. Its remote southern location helped it evolve a large number of endemic species, meaning to be found nowhere else in the world. We're first greeted by hundreds of marine iguanas, and we weren't sure if they were welcoming us or trying to block our path. They harmlessly stared at us as we tiptoed through their vast numbers. Marine iguanas hunt for food in the sea, and the Galapagos Islands are the only place in the world they're found. The black females blend into the lava rock, whereas the males stand out with their red markings, which turn greenish during the mating season. The species on this island are the only ones that change color.
So species,
the hood mockingbird stops by to greet us. It's slightly larger than the other mockingbirds found in the Galapagos. Its beak is longer and has more of a curved shape. The hood mockingbird on this island is the only carnivorous one, feeding on a variety of insects and turtle hatchlings. These small birds are Darwin finches. 13 species of finches reside on the islands. He recognized their diverse beak size and shape, adapted for different food sources. This lava lizard is also endemic to the island. They move quickly. As you see, he's curious, and he has rhythm. Also on our path, we come across blue-footed boobies, aptly named for their bright blue feet. The smaller white one is a baby.
Sometimes the female tends to be darker blue, but sometimes the same. But the female makes like a duck sound, and the male whistles. Right there. So that's the male whistles.
Notice their small yellow eyes. And the name booby is thought to come from the Spanish word bobo, meaning stupid. They feed on fish and are excellent divers, plunging into the water from as high as 80 feet. Half of the population is in the Galapagos here. The remainder can be found on coastal islands off of Baja California and Peru. Probably the star performer of Espanola Island is the waved albatross. They're also endemic to the island, so this is their only nesting place. And this one is a baby.
Here, because the albatross live here only from mid-April until December. In January, February, and March, they migrate.
Here we could see the adult albatrosses. These birds mate for life. Their spring ritual begins with the male's dance, which can take up to 5 days of strutting and honking and beak fencing, You can imagine what that looks like. And once the pair is reacquainted, they produce a single egg and they share the responsibility of incubation, where they'll remain until December, until the chick is fully grown. In January, the island's steep cliff serves as the perfect runway for a few months of migration to their ocean feeding grounds near the mainland of Ecuador and Peru. This fella's gonna leap off the cliff. The young albatross do not return to Espanola Island until their fourth or fifth year to seek a mate. The white ones are the Nasca Boobies. Ecuador annexed the islands in 1832, and they made the Galapagos a national park in 1959. They've implemented various steps to preserve the Galapagos. Today, 97% of the islands are a park, with tourism restricted to small boats and guided groups. And the number of boats are limited, and all must be registered and certified with the Ecuadorian government. All the tourists must be accompanied by a naturalist guide, and we can only walk on marked paths and cannot touch any of the animals. And the tour guides are also park rangers, and they'll report any unusual boats or activity. We head west to Floreana and enjoy some snorkeling before a quick visit to the island. This spot is called Devil's Crown due to its partially exposed cone of an extinct volcano. It has a great assortment of marine life and is considered one of the best spots for snorkeling and diving in the Galapagos. After snorkeling, our group sets off for Floreana Island. We really enjoyed the bay, especially the birds that came to entertain us. And here is an impressive pelican. This bird is a frigate.
It's got a pretty big wingspan.
We sail around large Isabela Island and stop at Fernandina Island, the youngest in the Galapagos. This island is an active shield volcano with frequent eruptions. Due to the volcanic activity, it has a rocky surface, and it's rimmed with a nice, lush forest of green mangroves. Hundreds of marine iguanas inhabit the dark rocky shores and the black sand beaches. This is the largest colony in the Galapagos, and we really had to carefully trek along as they blend into the surrounding. We get a good view of the volcano. It has erupted several times in the last few decades. The most recent large eruption was 2009, and it's had ongoing small activity ever since. These are flightless cormorants, endemic to the Galapagos. They are the only cormorant in the world who's lost the ability to fly. With less than 1,500 birds left, they're one of the rarest birds in the world.
And they don't fly anymore. They just change jobs from air pilots to dive masters.
The Galapagos penguin can also be spotted nesting in the area, although we don't see any on land ourselves. A couple thousand of them are endemic to the islands. They're about 14 inches in height and smaller and more duck-like than their southern cousins. I do manage to catch one on video while snorkeling at our next stop, and as you'll see, they're very fast swimmers. We head to the north end of Isabela Island for a stop at one of the most fascinating marine sites in the Galapagos. Isn't this beautiful? And look at those little turtles. We're at the base of Volcano Ecuador, which formed a protected bay teeming with wildlife. We ride along the coast, observing penguins, birds, seals, and sea lions. We then snorkel around two coves with incredible marine life. Of course, our highlight is the Galapagos Sea Turtles. I was fortunate to see a seal diving in the water beside me, and I catch a quick glimpse of a penguin shoot past like a miniature torpedo. We head to our last stop on Santa Cruz Island, where the highlights are the giant tortoises at the Darwin Research Station. Although the general policy in the Galapagos is not to interfere with the wildlife, an exception is made for the tortoises to help preserve the variety of species that are endemic to the islands. Notice the numbers on the back of their shells. This tracks which island they're from so that they can be returned once they're able to survive on their own with minimal risk. Tortoises are able to survive for months without food or water. During the devastating period of whaling and seal hunting between 1784 and 1860, each ship would load up around 200 tortoises as food, and as the supply dwindled on one island, they moved to another, eliminating some species. The Galapagos once had 15 tortoise species with a population of about 250,000, but today they have about 20,000, with four species extinct. When the station started its captive breeding program in the 70s, all species were endangered, but they managed to restore all but one to guarded levels. The best success story is that of the Hood Island tortoises. They started with only 2 males and 11 females. Miraculously, a third male named Diego, with a strong sex drive, was found at the San Diego Zoo and brought here to join the other tortoises. They're now proud parents to over 1,800 tortoises roaming free on Espanola Island. Diego will be returned to the island in March of 2020, where 40% of the population are believed to be his kids. Lonesome George here in the back is about 100 years old. He was the last of his species from Pinta Island, and therefore was considered the rarest animal in the world. Attempts to mate him with females of other species considered closest to his were unsuccessful. He died in 2012, just 2 years after our visit, and his species is now extinct. He's now taxidermied and resides here at the Charles Darwin Research Station.
These are the true saddleback.
Here we see Diego, the father with lots of kids.
You can even see the left side of a shell is broken, worn out. He came on first class on American Airlines from San Diego. And he speaks English.
The friendly close encounters with the Galapagos animals were a special treat. If you enjoy my videos, I encourage you to subscribe by clicking on my YouTube channel icon. It's free, and sharing with your friends is much appreciated. You can play another video by clicking a thumbnail on the right, and you could also find my videos by searching for Haswell Traveled on YouTube or Google.